rapture and left behind doctrine according to the Christian church. One day Christ is going to come back, he's going to crack the atmosphere, and he's going to gather and beam up all believers. The Christian church, everyone's going to get beamed up, and then there's going to be a mass amount of people that are left behind, because the ones that are left behind are the ones that didn't believe. And then the ones that are left behind, that's when the Antichrist is going to come on the scene, and the ones that are left behind, they're going to go through a seven-year tribulation period where they have 7 years of all trouble and turmoil. But when the believers got beamed up, that day is going to be a chaotic day, because there's going to be planes falling down on earth because the pilot got beamed up. There's going to be cars crashing all over the place. It's going to be chaotic because all these people are getting beamed up everywhere. And nobody's going to know what's going on. They're going to be confused. Then during the seven-year tribulation period when the Antichrist is on the scene, you're going to have 7 years to either believe or you're going to have to accept the mark of the beast. Those that believe, they're going to have to be beheaded because they didn't believe in time. They believed after the rapture. So now to show their allegiance with Christ, they're going to have to get beheaded. And the ones that receive the mark of the beast, they're going to be able to buy, sell, and continue on with life. But then after the end of the seven-year tribulation, Christ is going to come back, destroy the Antichrist, and then he's going to beam up everybody else. So he's going to make a third coming, according to the Christian doctrine. Then after that, everyone's going to live happily ever after, floating in the sky in heaven. The end type deal. Folks, that is a lie. That is a lie. That is not in the Bible. The way that story goes, that's not in the Bible. This is what happens when you let Gentiles teach the word of God. That is not in the Bible. That is a man-made doctrine. That's the Christian religion version of that doctrine, and they called it the rapture. Now what we're going to do is get ready to go inside of the Bible and see what God says about this rapture and about being left behind. And we're going to find out who's lying, because somebody's lying. You're going to be the judge. I'm Brother Yerasha. This is the Bible Unlocked, the rapture deception. Matthew 24, verse 3. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? The disciples came to Christ asking him, when is going to be the sign of thy coming? And what's going to be the end of the world? When it says the end of the world, it's talking about the end of the age or the end of that rulership, referring to the Roman Empire. This is a question that they wanted to know so they could be prepared for when he's making his next return. And Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. This is the first thing he told the disciples, is that you need to take heed that nobody comes to deceive you. There's going to be people using my name as a cover-up to push doctrine on you concerning the coming of me. He's telling you that the Christian church is going to be the number one deceptive tool used by Satan to deceive people. He says, many shall come in my name, referring to people who are going to be using the Bible to push a false doctrine on people. So you need to take that into consideration as we go into this lesson. Keep that in mind. That's what Christ was saying. He didn't say it was going to be Muslims or atheists. It's going to be people using the Bible to deceive people. And it says, this shall deceive many. This ain't talking about a few Israelites returning in the last days with the correct doctrine. This is talking about somebody who has a large scale of viewers to deceive, a large platform to deceive many people. It's referring to Christianity. See, Christianity is still waiting for this person to come, these people to come to deceive many. You're going to be waiting for a long time because you don't realize that it's talking about you. But of that day and hour knoweth no man. No, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. Christ says nobody knows when he's going to return. He don't know himself. The angels don't know. Only the Father in heaven knows the exact day and time that he's going to send forth the Son. But as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Keep this in mind. He's giving an analogy right now. He says the same way it happened during the time of Noah is the same exact way it's going to happen when he returns. Watch. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage. They were doing everything that they do on a normal day basis. Living life as if life was going to continue forever when Noah was out there telling people to get prepared. That the flood is going to get ready to come. Everybody just, they shunned them and they continued living life. Marrying, drinking, getting drunk, partying. You know, the same thing that we see going on today. Like as if the world is going to continue going on like this forever. That's what they were doing back then. That's what they're doing today. Nothing has changed. Until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and knew not until the flood came and took them all away, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Until Noah came into the ark. Everybody was eating and drinking until Noah came in the ark. And those other people outside of the ark, they knew not what was going on until the flood came and took them away. Remember this word took. This is very important. This is context, people. Remember this word took. It's going to be very important as we continue going down in the chapter. Took them away, meaning all the people that got taken away, they got killed. They got drowned in the flood. The Most High killed them all. Noah is the one. Noah and his family were the ones that got left behind. Everyone else got taken away. Watch. Then shall two be in the field, the one shall be taken and the other left. It's going to be two people in the field. One shall be taken. Remember, as the days of Noah were, it's the same exact way the Son of Man return is going to be. Two in the field, the one was taken. What does that mean? The one was killed. One was left behind, one was killed. That's what this is saying. It's not saying that he got beamed up into the sky. It's saying the same exact way as the days of Noah were. He got killed, the one who was taken. Two women shall be grinding at the mill. The one shall be taken and the other left. And it's two women grinding at the mill. One was taken, as in the days of Noah were, meaning she got killed, and the other one was left behind. You see how you've been deceived into thinking that it's a good thing to be taken? Taken means you got killed. You don't want to be taken. There's no rapture going on before the destruction comes. The one who got taken is the one who got killed. He's the one who got caught in the judgment of God. Remember, they were marrying, drinking in the days of Noah, and it's going to be the same exact way. They got caught, so that means they got caught. Christ said he's returning as a thief in the night. These people got caught in sin, and they were taken. You have to understand that this is how crazy religion is. This is how hypnotizing religion can be. If this verse were in another history book, and it was written in this context, people would be able to understand this thing clearly. Clearly, they would be understanding, okay, taken means that they got killed. That's a negative thing. But when it comes, just because it's in the Bible, people's mind cannot perceive it. Because you've been pushed a rapture doctrine on you for so long, you can't understand something as simple as this. One word changed everyone's perception of this whole thing. They made you believe that being taken was a good thing. They made you believe that being taken somehow equated to being beamed up in the sky. This has nothing to do with that at all. You were taken, that means you were killed. So now we're going to go into the Apocrypha, which is books that are part of the Old Testament that were removed by the Christian church between the 17th and the 18th century. They removed these books because with these books in there, it expounds on a lot of the doctrines, and it goes contrary to what people teach in Christianity today. It expounds on the left behind and what it means to be taken. It expounds on that. It shows you where Christ is quoting from. This book is part of the Bible, the King James Version 1611. It's part of the original Bible that the Christian church thought that it was meet to take out, because you cannot push a left behind doctrine and a rapture doctrine with these books in there. So they decided to remove them. 2 Ezra chapter 13, verse 15. Show me now yet the interpretation of this dream. Ezra is having a dream, a prophetic dream. Prior in the chapter, he's seeing the coming of Christ. He's seeing the return of Christ. So now he wants to know, what is the interpretation and the meaning of this dream? This is referring to Christ's coming. For as I conceive in mine understanding, woe unto them that shall be left in those days. So he says, the way I understand it, the way I can conceive in my understanding, he says, woe unto them that are left in those days. The word woe means destruction. He says it's going to be some destruction to those that are left in those days. And much more woe unto them that are not left behind. But it's much more destruction to those that were taken. Those that were killed, those that were not left. He says it's a much more destruction, because the people that are left behind, it's still going to be some troubles. It's going to be troubles and it's going to be tribulation. But it's much more woe and destruction for those that did not make it, those that got caught up in the judgment of God. You have a bigger penalty to pay if you got taken. For they that were not left, heaviness. Because after the 1,000-year reign of Christ, these people have to get resurrected again, and you have to be judged by the Most High himself. You have to stand and meet the Most High himself. The ones who are left behind and make it through the tribulation, they get to reign with Christ 1,000 years. And the second death, or the lake of fire, they're not in jeopardy of getting that lake of fire. But the ones who were taken, you are in jeopardy of getting the lake of fire, because you have to do the final judgment. You have to go through that. It tells you about that in the book of Revelation 20, that the dead and everyone else that was left has to be risen. Some going to be to everlasting life, and some to everlasting damnation. Now you're in jeopardy of that. So you don't want to be the one that's taken. Now understand I the things that are laid up in the latter days, which shall happen unto them and to those that are left behind. Therefore are they come into great perils and many necessities, like as these dreams declare. The word peril means imminent danger, because it is going to be danger for the ones that are left behind. It is going to be danger. It's going to be a survival zone. Yet it is easier for him that is in danger to come into these things than to pass away as a cloud out of the world and not to see these things that happen in the last days. Ezra is saying you're not getting lifted up in no cloud. You're not getting taken away in no cloud. He says you are going to see the things that happen in the last days. There's no way out of it. Whether you left behind or taken, you are going to see the destruction that happens. There's no way out of it. You're not getting beamed up into no cloud. You're not going to escape it. You are going to see it. And he answered unto me and said, the interpretation of the vision shall I show thee, and I will open unto thee the things that thou hast required. Whereas thou hast spoken of them that are left behind, this is the interpretation. He that shall endure the peril in that time hath kept himself. This is the same exact thing when Christ says in Matthew 24, he that shall endure into the end. He that makes it into the end, that's the one that's going to be saved. But this is the person who has been keeping the commandments. He has kept himself from the wickedness of the world. This is the one who's left behind, who has made it through the tribulation. He's made it. He wasn't involved in the wickedness. He wasn't taken by the flood. They that be fallen into danger are such as have works and faith towards the Almighty. You need works and faith, meaning you must be keeping the commandments and you have to have faith at the same time. They go one and the same. They're hand in hand. If you have works, meaning you are keeping the commandments and you were living your life accordingly to what God says, that shows that you have faith. Keeping the commandments shows that you believe that there's a greater reward at the end, and that you believe if you keep these commandments that you will be saved from the wrath of the Most High. That faith and works go hand in hand. It tells you about that in the book of James. You can't have one without the other. Know this therefore, that they which be left behind are more blessed than they that be dead. I need to read this again. Know this therefore, that they which be left behind are more blessed than they that be dead. It says that they that are left behind, and contrary to what the Christian church teaches, are more blessed than they that be dead, showing you that the ones that were taken got killed. The Most High God killed you. You were taken in his wrath. You were taken by the plagues. You were taken by the flood, as in the days of Noah. You were taken in sin. You got caught as a thief in the night. You weren't on watch. You were not on guard. There's no rapture being beamed up into the sky. You're not being beamed up into the sky. You're going to see the judgment, whether you want to or whether you don't want to. This is the meaning of the vision. Whereas thou sawest a man coming up from the midst of the sea, the same is he whom God the highest hath kept a great season. This is talking about Christ. This is talking about the Son of God. Now he's showing him the interpretation of the dream. Now he's saying that you're seeing the Son of God, the one who the Most High has reserved for a season, which by his own self shall deliver his creature, and he shall order them that are left behind. Now Christ is going to gather everyone else that is left behind, the ones that did not get killed and taken. Christ is going to order them and gather them together. He that shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved. This is a marathon. It's not a quick race. You have to last to the end. This is survival right here. This is survival. You're not trying to be taken away. So Christ is going to gather you at the end. Now this goes right hand in hand with one of the main verses that Christians twist to say that they're going to get raptured up into the sky before the destruction happens. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. This goes hand in hand with what we just read. Hand in hand. It pieces it right together perfectly. So after the tribulation happens and everyone is getting destroyed and taken, then the ones that remained, then Christ is going to come back and gather them. Those are the ones that are going to be gathered to meet him. You've endured to the end. You've made it. This ain't before the destruction. This is after the destruction. 2 Ezra 16 verse 22. For many of them that dwell upon the earth shall perish of famine, and the other that escape the hunger shall the sword destroy. These are the ones who got taken. It's going to be many people that perish or be taken by famine. And if the ones that escape the famine, the sword is going to come. The destruction is going to come. Those are the ones who got taken. And the dead shall be cast out as dung, and there shall be no man to comfort them, for the earth shall be wasted, and the cities shall be cast down. There shall be no man left to till the earth and to sow it. There's going to be so many people that's dead. Nobody's going to be turning over the tilling the ground, planting seeds in there, growing crops. It's going to be so many people that's taken that the earth is going to be, it's just going to be wasted. The trees shall give fruit, and who shall gather them? The grapes shall ripen, and who shall tread them? And it's going to be apples, oranges, everything, all the trees going to be blossoming with fruit, but nobody's going to be grabbing any fruit. Why? Because everyone was taken. Most people are taken. They were taken as in the days of Noah by the flood. They were taken by the Most High's wrath. For all places shall be desolate of men, so that one man shall desire to see another and to hear his voice. And it's going to be so bad that one man is going to be, you're going to be looking around trying to find where the rest of the people are. You're going to wish that you can hear somebody's voice. You want to see another human. You're going to, where's everybody at? All the people were taken. They were all destroyed. You're going to be seeing dead bodies all over the floor. You're going to be trying to live. Where's one live human being at? Where are they at? I need to look for these people. Where are they at? For of a city, there shall be 10 left and 2 of the field, which shall hide themselves in the thick groves and in the clefts of the rocks. That's what's going to happen. So when in Matthew 24, when it says 2 in the field, one was taken, the other one was left. The one that was left, now it's survival time. It's survival time now. Now you're going to be running around. It's going to be 10 people left in a city. Imagine that. 10 people left in a city. Everybody else was taken, killed. And now you're looking around like, where is everyone at? Where is it? Can I find one live person? You're going to be hiding yourself in other places from the destruction and the wrath that God has let loose. The last plague that he has let loose.
Nothing happened the way it was supposed to happen. My name is Robert Neville. I'm a survivor living in New York City. I am broadcasting on all AM frequencies. If you are out there, if anyone is out there, please.
Psalms 91 verse 2. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God. In him will I trust. When the last destruction comes, this is the one we're going to be trusting on the Most High. Not the God of Christianity, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the real God of the Bible, the Most High. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. The truth of God is going to be the shield. The truth of God is found in the Bible. The truth of God telling you that you need to keep God's commandments. That's our protection. It don't matter how far down in earth you dig to try to hide yourself. There's no way to escape the day of the Lord. There's no way to escape it. There's no way to escape it. The only way you can escape it is if you keep God's commandments. That's it. That's why he says the truth shall be the shield and buckler. We're not going to be able to, there's no weapons that's going to be able to protect you from God's wrath. Thou shalt not be afraid of the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day. The arrow that flieth by day is talking about missiles and nuclear destruction. That's what he's seeing. It looks like an arrow flying. He says we're not going to be worried about that because there's going to be destruction all over the place. Bombs flying here, missiles flying there, nuclear destruction everywhere. Nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. You're going to be looking at 1,000 people drop dead on the left hand, and you're going to be looking at 10,000 on the right hand drop dead. Remember in Esdras it says, 10 shall be left in the city. This is how it's going to be 10 left in the city. Everybody's going to be taken and dropping dead. They're going to be killed. Because they are not going to be keeping God's commandments. They're going to be doing like the days of Noah, eating, drinking, marrying, as if life is going to continue on forever. Caught up in entertainment, caught up in all the things of society, the luxuries of this world, and not of the Most High. Caught up in religion and man-made philosophy. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. And you're going to be looking around. You're not going to be raptured up and beamed up. You're going to be actually looking around at people dropping dead. With your eyes shall ye see the reward of the wicked. Who's the wicked? The ones telling you that you don't have to keep God's commandments. That you can just sit back and believe. People that want to push Satan's agenda on people. Those are the wicked. That's the reward that they're going to get. Now it's time to get the reward. You've been living life this whole time freely and living life as if it's going to continue going on and that you're never going to have to pay for anything you've done. Now you get to see, now the reward is paying off. Your reward is you get to be kept alive, the ones who's keeping the commandments, and now you get to see the reward of the wicked. The all atheists, all the people that did not want to bow down to God's commandments, that's their reward. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. Because you made God your habitation, your dwelling place. You didn't make the riches of the world and philosophies. That wasn't what you had your mind on. You had your mind meditated on God's laws. David says in the book of Psalms, he meditates day and night on God's laws. Because that's what's going to be the salvation at the end. At least attempting to the best of your ability to keep God's laws. 2 Thessalonians 2 verse 10. And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. What is God saying? The people who are going to perish are the ones who don't want to receive the love of the truth. They don't actually really want to know the truth. They want to believe what makes them feel comfortable. They don't think care less about what the Bible says. They just want to believe what tingles their emotions inside. What sits well with them? That's what people like doing. People don't care about the truth. Most people don't care about the truth. They love living in a delusion. So for that, God says you're going to perish. And for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion that they should believe a lie. What was the strong delusion God sent? Christianity. What was the strong delusion God sent? All you have to do is sit back and believe, and I'm going to be sitting on the couch, don't have to keep none of God's laws. I'm going to sit back, and one day because I believe, I'm just going to get beamed up. Before all the destruction happens to everyone else, just because I sit down and I say, I believe, I'm going to get beamed up. God says, because you want to believe that, and you don't want to do what is right, he says, I'm going to send you the strong delusion. Not Satan, I'm going to send it to you. God sent the strong delusion, And he's going to say, I'm going to allow you to believe it. Even though the Bible that you say you believe in says something totally opposite, you prefer to believe a man and religion and philosophy and men's doctrine. Since you want to believe that, God says, I'm going to let you believe that. Because at the end, it's going to be destruction. You're going to perish for believing that. This, God, he has a weeding out process. And this is part of the weeding out process. Believing doctrines like the rapture and Left Behind. All the movies that they have out there. People love to believe that thing versus going in the Bible and seeing what it says. People want to believe what those type of mysticisms. So God has a weeding out process that's going to catch you at the end. And it's going to bite you. That they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but have pleasure in unrighteousness. Unrighteousness means sin. Sin means breaking God's laws in the Bible. They had pleasure in saying, God's laws are done away with. I can do whatever I want. I'm everything. I can do whatever I want. All I have to do is sit back and say, I believe. The devil believes. The demons believe. They all believe in Christ. They all know who he is. That don't mean anything. Just because you say, I believe, the devil believes. But since you want to believe that and want to have pleasure in unrighteousness, God has a plan for you. God has a plan for you. Like they always say in the Christian church, God has a plan for you. Yes, he has a plan for you. All right. Absolutely. You're right about that. And it ain't going to be good. Acts 14, verse 22. Confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorting them to continue in the faith, and that we must through much tribulation enter into the kingdom of God. Christians don't want to hear this verse. They don't want to hear it through much tribulation. This is part of the strong delusion of the rapture, saying that you're going to get raptured up prior to the tribulation. The Bible says clearly, through much tribulation shall we enter into the kingdom of God. Not through sitting back on your couch, eating potato chips, and then getting beamed up one day because all you do is believe. The disciples of Christ all had to die vicious deaths. Every last one of them died vicious deaths, Paul included, either by getting beheaded or stoned. They all died vicious deaths. Christ died a vicious death on the cross for this word. He says that the servant is not above his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you. But y'all don't believe that. We know that already. You believe Christianity and doctrines of man and philosophy, that you're going to get raptured up prior. I bet you that the disciples wish they could have got raptured up before the tribulation, before they got put to death. You know how great that would have sounded to them, that they were going to get raptured up? They knew that that was nonsense. And the Bible says through much tribulation. I'm going to say it again. Through much tribulation. That does not mean a few bumps here and there. That means you're going to have to go through some things in order to get into the kingdom of God. It's like anything else we see in life. Everything else you have to work for. You want a house? You need to work for it. You want a car? You need to work for it. You want an education? You got to work for it. You want a job? You got to work for it. Everything you do, you have to work for it. But somehow people lose that train of thought when it comes to when they jump and delve into the Bible. And they think that everything else they have to work for makes sense. But for some reason, when it comes to God's kingdom, we don't have to do nothing for that. Just sit back, go to church on Sunday, and say we believe. That's part of the strong delusion. Christ warned you, many will come in his name and deceive many. And many people bear record of that, that prophecy has been fulfilled. Now, what's the objective behind pushing this rapture doctrine on millions or billions of people? The objective is to pacify people and keep people in a delusional state and keep people pacified so that they will not be worried about any true issues going on. Because the way that the church pushes it is that, well, if we're still here and we're not raptured, then that means we don't have anything to worry about yet. Because the church is not raptured yet. That is part of the psychological training that has been pushed on people. So while you got government and you got secret societies operating and planning this destruction, getting ready to happen, they got you pacified because you have in your mind nothing's going to happen yet because the church is still here. The church is still here. So if the church is here, we're in good hands. So we can go right along with all the programs that they put out and we can be like puppets. That's what it is. Psychological warfare going on right now, and you have no clue. You're losing the battle. Trust me, you're losing the battle. This Christianity is the strongest drug out there. It's worse than being put on any type of heroin, cocaine. This is the strongest drug because it gets right into the mental capacities of people. It'll have you not being able to understand something as simple as took in that context. People can't understand it. Like, and it's very... It's amazing how that happens. It's just amazing how the psychological training these people are capable of doing. Satan, man, I'm telling you, Satan, when it says he transforms himself into an angel of light, people have underestimated Satan for the longest time. When it says he deceived the whole world, this thing is absolutely true. And it's for simple things that people could easily catch if they were in a classroom environment. If they were in any other type of environment, people would be able to catch these things like it was nothing. They'd be able to read the context and say, okay, I know exactly what it's talking about. But because it's in religion and in the Bible, you got the smartest people in the world, people that are intelligent, as far as other can't even understand this. It's all psychological warfare, and it's psychology meant to have you pacified so you would believe in your mind that nothing matters because the church is still here. Take heed that no man deceives you, like Christ said. Ecclesiastes 12, verse 13. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter, fear God and keep his commandments. For this is the whole duty of, this is the conclusion of the whole matter, the whole lesson. This is still the conclusion. You have to fear God and keep his commandments. Because the day of destruction is near. And if you don't want to keep his commandments, that's fine. You will be taken. You will get your rapture wish. But it's not going to be the rapture you think it is. It's going to be death and destruction, wrath and vengeance on those that hate God and keep not his commandments. That's what it's going to be. Let's find out what these commandments are that you need in order to be left behind and endure to the end, to be saved. Leviticus 19, verse 13. Thou shalt not defraud thy neighbor, neither rob him. The wages of him that is hired shall not abide with thee all night until the morning. So if you have a hired brother and you owe him money and you have the money, you need to give him his wages and don't be trying to keep it. Oh, I'll pay you next week. Or I'll pay you next month. You need to give the man his wages so he can go on about his business. Don't be withholding your neighbor's wages. That's what this is saying. Is this law hard to keep? You see, I understand exactly why people have to die to death that don't want to keep God's commandments. This is something simple. This is a simple commandment that people don't want to follow. They say it's done away with. I see exactly why God has to bring wrath. And it makes perfect sense. So this is how you have to treat your neighbor. This is called love thy neighbor as thyself. You wouldn't want nobody else holding your wages after you've worked all day for them. Imagine at your job, when they don't pay you on time. You don't like that. You don't want somebody a week late with your check. If you got the wages, pay your brother and keep it moving. With that, I'm Brother Yerushalayim. This is the Bible Unlocked. And until next time, I say shalom. Mm-hmm.